My last video about vehicle to grid got a lot of negative response. So I'm going to give you a start with JB Straubel.
If we want to actually send energy back from the car to the electricity grid, this gets much more complex. That's something that I don't see being a very economic or viable solution, and perhaps ever, but certainly not in the near term.
Later on in this video, I'm going to break down all of what Straubel had to say at that forum regarding batteries, including vehicle to grid and using vehicle batteries after the vehicle life is over for grid storage. He talked about a few other things. I'm going to cover that towards the end of this video. In my first video, I compared vehicle to grid to robotaxi, and I got a lot of objections that, well, we don't know when robotaxi will be live. So I'm mostly going to leave robotaxi out of this. I'm going to show a bunch of other reasons why vehicle to grid doesn't work, and I'm going to address some of the other criticisms that were made. Another thing I saw in the comments is a lot of people seem to think it won't cost very much to use your Tesla vehicle as a power wall and plug into the grid. This is grossly underestimating how much that cost would be. So Ronnie, for example, said it should be under $1,000. Way off. Sure, you can find a study that assumes that the cost of the wiring upgrades would be $650 to $1,500, but that doesn't mean that's the real price. A couple sources indicate the cost would be in the ballpark of $5,000, and guess what that's in line with? If you go to the Tesla website and you shop for a Powerwall, one Powerwall is $11,000, and it goes up $6,000 for each Powerwall you add. What that means is the installation cost is $5,000 to have Tesla put one or more Powerwalls in your house. $5,000, that's the same number. And that $5,000 cost is just connecting to your house. That doesn't include whatever else might be necessary to connect to the grid. And another thing, people just don't get that the revenue from vehicle to grid is far too low to be worth the effort. In most situations, most energy generators get paid between $30 and $40 a megawatt hour for electricity, which works out to 3 to 4 cents a kilowatt hour. Even if you manage to get 10 cents a kilowatt hour for that energy, it wouldn't be enough to justify doing vehicle to grid. Something no one talks about is how fast would your vehicle send power up to the grid? At best, you're probably talking about 2 or 3 kilowatts per hour. My best guess is 2 kilowatts per hour. That's just not a lot of energy going up. You're just not getting a lot for your time of your vehicle stuck on the grid. If you did manage to get 10 cents a kilowatt hour, that would still only work out to 20 cents an hour. More likely, you're talking about 3 cents a kilowatt hour, which works out to 6 cents an hour. It just doesn't make sense. You can compare that number to driving, and you can take it out of the robotaxi world where I figure robotaxis are worth $1 per mile. The IRS reimbursement rate is close to 60 cents a mile. Even if you work out 50 cents a mile and you average 20 miles an hour in your car, you're getting $10 an hour for your time, not 20 cents an hour. You can also think about it in terms of cycles. If you have a car with a 4,000 cycle battery life, and that car costs $40,000 like a typical Model 3 costs right now, that costs $10 per battery cycle. Now compare that to if you supply the grid with energy at 10 cents a kilowatt hour, your 50 kilowatt hour battery pack is earning you $5 in vehicle to grid per cycle. $5, it costs you $10 per cycle to buy the car. You're losing money. You make $20,000 over the life of the car you paid $40,000 for. Contrast that with the driving value at, say, a 50 cent a mile rate, less than the IRS reimbursement rate, and a 250 mile cycle is $125 worth of driving value for you. Far more than the cost of the car and far more than the electricity value. I'm going to go through what JB Straubel had to say next, but first I wanted to address one other thing I keep seeing. There are people who say, well, when I get my car, I don't want people using it as a robotaxi. I want to keep it for myself. I don't want people getting it dirty, whatever. That's fine, but the problem is that once robotaxis do become real, the cost of a robotaxi is going to be $200,000 or more. Are you going to buy a robotaxi type vehicle and stick it in your garage and not use it? You can just buy a cheap ICE vehicle if you're not going to drive it. Buy a cheap ICE vehicle that's not self-driving and pay $20,000. Why would you pay $200,000 for something you're not going to use? One more point on this. If Tesla's mission is to accelerate the world's transition to sustainable energy, and you buy a Tesla and you leave it in your garage and you only drive it 2 hours a day, then you're decelerating the transition to sustainable energy. Robotaxi use, where the vehicle is used a lot, is what accelerates the transition, because that replaces internal combustion engine cars and it reduces pollution and it makes our world a better place. Now we're going to go through the question that JB Straubel was asked at this forum and go in detail through his answer. Keep in mind when you listen to this how this relates to Tesla's goal of accelerating the transition to sustainable energy. It's not just about profit. I think they're aligned. Profit is aligned with the acceleration of our transition to sustainable energy. But deep down, if you think about it, this is really about that transition. Here we go.
You talked about what you do with the batteries at the end of their life, and you say you'd melt them down and make new batteries.
This is the first nugget in this clip, just him mentioning that Tesla's plan is to melt down the batteries at the end of their life and then reuse the materials. They're not planning to salvage the batteries and continue to use them in some form. They're going to melt them down. I didn't hear Straubel say that in his presentation earlier in this video, but he said it and Straubel didn't deny it, so that's something new.
Of course, one alternative would be to use those batteries, which maybe have declined in efficiency, in static locations to help even out the unpredictability of renewable energy supply. But I wonder if you'd taken that one stage further, because you know you will have a lot of customers around the world who have downloaded cheap electricity at night when the wind was blowing, or maybe in the daytime when the sun was shining, who maybe don't need their car on a particular day. Have you looked at how they could then upload that electricity to the grid to help even out the unpredictability of supply from renewables and actually become electricity traders using their car as the bank?
There was a lot in that convoluted question. For one thing, he referenced the idea that batteries from cars would be used for stationary storage, which you're going to hear later Straubel's going to reject. But in the end, he goes right for vehicle-to-grid, as if vehicle-to-grid is a solution and is Tesla considering it. Straubel's going to get there in his answer, which is coming up right now.
Yeah, we've looked at reuse, or kind of the second life of automotive batteries for grid applications, you know, very, very closely. And you know, ultimately, every time we've studied this, we come to the conclusion that it's not a very economical or very good use of those assets.
Right there, Straubel just body slams the idea. No, we don't use vehicle batteries for stationary assets. We've looked at it. It's not a good idea. And he's going to explain next why it's not a good idea.
You know, by the time they come out of a transport, out of a vehicle that's lived its life, you know, the technology will be quite old. You know, we expect 10, maybe 15 year life at a minimum from these batteries.
This was a really good idea that I honestly hadn't thought of. If you imagine a Tesla Model S that started in 2013 and it has a 10 year life, so 10 years later is 2023, the battery technology in the 2013 Model S is going to be so grotesquely outdated that why would you want to use that old battery tech? Batteries are improving so rapidly, it's amazing, and they just don't need to use old batteries, old outdated batteries anymore.
And you know, the degradation is not entirely linear. You know, by the end of their life, you know, the efficiency has degraded. On every cycle, you see lower efficiency. The capacity will have somewhat degraded. And for a lot of reasons, you know, it makes it very difficult to deploy those efficiently back into a grid setting where you want high reliability and you do want predictability.
This is another big point. Those older batteries have degraded in a variety of ways, and reliability and predictability are particularly important when they're being used for grid storage and grid backup. And Tesla is not going to do that. They're going to use new batteries instead.
You know, my view is that we'll see, you know, new batteries dedicated to that market that also have slightly different characteristics. They should have higher cycle life. In an electric vehicle that has, you know, 200 plus miles of range, you don't need as many cycles as you do on a battery that's designed to charge and discharge every single day on the grid. You know, there's perhaps about a factor of 4 or 5 difference in the cycle life.
That was a really interesting detail, that as of 2016, Tesla's energy storage battery chemistries had 4 or 5 times the cycle life of the vehicle batteries. Now keep in mind, Elon mentioned at one point in the past that the grid storage batteries they were using did have 4,000 cycles. So that does seem to fit.
Ready to play power pack with 4,000 cycle life capability.
To your second question about, you know, using vehicles as a buffer for renewable energy.
Just to be clear, in this bit, he's not talking about vehicle to grid. He's talking about the timing of when Tesla vehicles are going to charge so that they don't charge from the grid at bad moments when the grid is under high demand.
You know, this is definitely something that's coming. And I think there's two ways to implement this. The first is to use dynamic charging. And this is essentially intelligently commanding when the vehicles absorb their energy from the grid, you know, to match up with when you have renewable energy available or cheap. This is something we can do very, very easily with just essentially software and controls. We don't have to change any of the hardware, and there's no additional regulatory or certification work needed. It's just essentially controlling the timing of when something would otherwise happen.
And now here he gets into vehicle to grid.
If we want to actually send energy back from the car to the electricity grid, this gets much more complex. That's something that I don't see being a very economic or viable solution in perhaps ever, but certainly not in the near term. The additional wear and tear and degradation on your vehicle battery has a fairly high cost. And many of the people and small businesses looking at this today, don't take into account fully that degradation cost.
A big reason why vehicle to grid doesn't make sense is because it degrades the battery, and the cost of degrading the battery is greater than the revenue you're getting from the grid.
And also the additional interconnection cost. Because if you interconnect your vehicle, you do have new regulations that play a part. It has to interconnect in the same way that a solar system would on someone's home or on a business, which have different standards so that they can protect line operators and people on the grid.
It's the interconnection cost, what I talked about earlier in this video. It costs a lot to set things up so that your vehicle can add energy to the grid. It's just not going to happen. There's your JB Straubel smackdown to vehicle to grid. Hey, thanks for watching. I hope you liked this video. If you disagree, please let me know in the comments. If you like it, or if you have other thoughts in the comments, please say what you got to say. If you love the video, please share it. Please subscribe, tell your friends, and look me up on Twitter and yell at me there if you need to. Thanks again for watching, and of course, check out these other videos around here. I think there might be something else you want to see. Thanks!